Why are there so many stories of people in hedge funds who hold a losing position to their destruction? Why didn't they just close the position and accept the loss while it was small? The answer to this includes many psychological terms, but one of the big ones that affects investors and prevents some people from becoming successful traders has to do with something called cognitive dissonance. We will briefly go over this and other related terms, and then we'll get to the live trading example from a popular YouTuber called ClayTrader, which inspired me to make this video. And don't you dare just skip to that fun part. You have to eat your vegetables before you can have dessert. So buckle up, go to the store, buy a notebook and a pencil, come back, throw the notebook away, and use your phone to take notes. When we have two conflicting beliefs, or a behavior doesn't match a belief, we experience cognitive dissonance, which is just your brain at war with itself. Psychologists love making sure that only other psychologists know what they're talking about, so they use big words and overcomplicate everything. I, however, didn't get into psychology to try and figure out what's wrong with myself. Sorry, psychologists. So, your brain is at war with itself because of two things that can't coexist. You can't smoke a cigarette and believe that smoking is bad for you without experiencing inner conflict, so something has to change. You could change your belief, I'm going to die anyways, or cigarettes look like carrots, so they're actually good for you, and they improve your eyesight, or you change your behavior by quitting. Cognitive dissonance, aka brain war, is something we try to avoid because it's uncomfortable, so we change our thoughts or our behaviors to make peace. Makes sense, right? Right. Right, left, right. Sorry. So how does this apply to trading? No idea. Just kidding. Admitting when we're wrong can be hard. In real life, I have no problem with admitting I'm wrong. I don't know what this guy's doing, but that's definitely not how I say I was wrong. I actually like learning new things and changing my beliefs. However, when it comes to the market, the stock market. I messed up very badly when I first started, and it never would have happened if I had just admitted I was wrong. I was buying puts and calls because, at the time, Facebook was insanely range-bound and just kept bouncing off the same prices. Also, somehow I just kept being right an insane amount of times by basically just completely guessing. I was like, wow, this is so easy. But the day inevitably came when I bought a put and Facebook didn't go down. So, I bought another put. Then, another put. I ended up with like $20,000 worth of puts and I held them into the weekend. I was actually snowshoeing with my fiancé and secretly pulling out Robinhood every 10 minutes to see if I was still down. It was a Thursday or Friday, and I held it through the weekend instead of taking a pretty small loss of like $400. On Monday, I called it quits and realized a loss of $2,400. It was humiliating, humbling, and an expensive trading lesson, but something I'll never do again. If there were no emotions involved and I was a robot, would I have continued to average down on a losing position, or would I have closed the position to minimize the loss? I mean, I don't think an automatic chocolate machine robot would have been better, but... there we go, that's better. I talk about how I prevent this from even being possible for me to do again later in the video. With cognitive dissonance comes rationalization, which is when we avoid difficult feelings by trying to explain our thoughts and behaviors rationally. Let me think of an example. Oh, I know. Like, instead of realizing I'm an idiot and minimizing my loss, I will continue to average down my cost on a short-term expiring option. I'm like the next Warren Buffett, and instead of closing my position, I will be greedy when others are fearful. Haha, that's my edge. Other people would be scared and close their position, but not me. I'm never wrong. Therefore, I will 20x the size of my position so I can get a better deal on these Facebook puts before the price opens $10 down Monday morning. And then reality hit, and I realized I was a degenerate. Degenerate. Having lost the physical, mental, or moral qualities considered normal and desirable. I rationalized not just staying in that position, but actually adding to it. This is as real as it gets. I was like Sang-woo from Squid Game, the one who lost all of his money trading. Just to summarize and put this as simply as possible, admitting when you're wrong is hard. When a position goes against us, it causes cognitive dissonance because we have a situation where the screen is telling us that we messed up, but we believe we are smart. Messing up makes us feel dumb, and those two things can't coexist. We don't like to question ourselves because it threatens the beliefs that make us who we are. If we mess up, Does that imply we are dumb? No. But it's easier to double down on why we did something instead of exiting and thinking about why we should not have done it. Cognitive dissonance happens during trading because events happen that don't agree with our beliefs about ourselves. Yes, loss aversion and loss as being painful are at play here, but can you guess what I'm about to say? That's a topic for another video. Next topic. Identifying with your beliefs is dangerous. Let's think about this intuitively for a minute. If I think of myself as the person who believes that birds are government drones, and I discover that birds are actually real animals, then who even am I anymore? Maybe a bad example. If who I am revolves around some political belief or belief about life itself, and I find indisputable evidence that says I'm wrong, then I'm going to be hurt very deeply. If we trade with an ego and attach a little part of ourselves to each transaction, then the result of these trades affects who we are. And we will be struggling to make the right moves during the trade because we have attached more weight to it than it deserves. We can't let the results of an ongoing trade affect our sense of self, because that will have an extremely dangerous impact on our ability to manage risk. I'll try to reword that more simply. Let's say Kevin is trading the opening range break strategy on Tesla. He buys a call option because he believes that it's going to break the price range from the first 10 minutes of trading to the upside. Kevin is a guy whose identity is largely based on his belief that he is a smart person. He's good at trivia, problem solving, and he's very proud of these skills that he has. It's a big part of his core sense of self. When he thinks about who he is as a person, smart is what comes to mind. So, he buys this call option, the price gets up to the top of the range, it stalls, it looks like it's going to go through, and then it instantly plummets down and his position goes negative. A trading algorithm running his strategy might have exited right then. But, what does Kevin do? He holds the position, because exiting means he was wrong. Being wrong implies that he isn't smart. Not being smart means he's wrong about himself. Not knowing who he is means he's lost his sense of identity. Losing his sense of identity results in an existential crisis. An existential crisis leads to him joining a cult, and joining a cult leads him to believe that the world is flat and that we're in a simulation run by an advanced species of lizards. Don't be like Kevin. If you identify with your trading beliefs, you will end up thinking there are lizard people. It will make it harder and more painful for you to exit a position when you are wrong. And hey, if you do chart trading, you've got an automatic stop loss anyways, so you won't have to deal with this problem as much. On my account, I disabled the ability for the position size to be more than one, and here's why. There are two possibilities when I take a trade. Either I was right about it, or I will get stopped out and the position will be closed. I'm not going to average down on a position looking for a bounce, because the one time it doesn't bounce could be the destruction of my account and possibly the entire world. Well, maybe not the second part. But you don't know that for sure. Also, what a terrible habit that would be. We need to learn where to get our entries instead of just lazily adding to a position every once in a while to get a decent cost average. Of course, that's great for investing, but that's not what this is about. I know that because I made this. Also, listen to this quote from a channel called SciShow Psych, who summarizes it nicely. We'll go a long way to reduce the feeling that our thoughts or actions don't line up with the way we see ourselves or the world. When we take a bad trade that we need to exit, we will act pretty irrationally in order to reduce the feeling that this behavior doesn't match with what we believe about ourselves. You're about to see a perfect example of this. Another helpful thing, he said, which ties into my cognitive behavioral guide, is that the first step in defeating our brain is knowing what it's up to. Okay, congratulations. You've made it through the boring part. Now, it's time for an example of cognitive dissonance and rationalization. Before I start, though, I need to clarify that this has nothing to do with criticizing the reasons for him taking this trade. I'm good with psychology, and I may be doing well with my sim trading, but I do not have the authority to criticize anyone for the specific reasons that they take a trade. What I do have the authority to do is comment on the psychology concepts at play once the trade has started. Here we go.
In there at 30, let's see the break and continuation now.
Okay. For context, he initiates a long position here with 500 shares because the trend line, which is resistance, has been broken by that candle.
There's the break of 30, then a quick rejection.
Price did break $30, but then it came right back down. He's currently $354 down, which you can see on the bottom right.
Giving this thing some wiggle room here.
So his plan was for the trend line break to mean the beginning of a big move upwards, but that didn't happen. So now, to adapt, he will rationalize staying in the trade in order to not realize the loss. Just in case there were a few of you watching this that might not know what that means, an unrealized loss is when your position has lost money, but you haven't closed it yet. Technically, you only lose that money once you close the position. The plan was that the price would go up after breaking resistance, but it didn't, so now he is saying that he needs to give it some wiggle room. This is what our brain does to trick us. If his plan was to give it more wiggle room, then he would not have initiated his position when he did. It's easy to see how him not exiting is completely contradictory to the entire reason he's taking this trade. But emotions don't operate on logic, and if you've seen the cognitive behavioral guide, you know how dangerous this is.
But maybe I just got suckered in by the false move up through that trend line. So let's see if it does want to come back up here. Again, I'm in at 29.99, so right at that 30 mark where I wanted.
Okay, currently he's down $1,324. The stock's price is at $27.24. This means the stock is down 9.2%. Now he's really committed. The worse a loss gets, the more our brain will work to rationalize staying in it. You're seeing a perfect example of this. This was not his trade. This was not his plan when he took the trade.
Now the question is, do I want to add if it wants to come back up? Again, same premise, maybe a failed breakdown, come up here, add it, let's call it 29. But I got to see some strength first.
Do you see any strength here?
So let's see if this thing wants to come back up here to, 28.
He's currently down over $1,700, and the stock is now down 11.6% from his entry.
Market opens up here in about 5 minutes, which is why I'm giving this a little space, because I could see this quite quickly turning itself back around.
Now he has created an entirely new reason to justify staying in the trade. Our brains will reach out at anything that confirms what we want to believe. Once again, this was not part of his plan. Also, you could use the market opening in 5 minutes to justify exiting the position, since increased volatility could go either way. A reason to do something that happens to be the same reason for doing the opposite thing is not a good reason to do something. Don't worry, that confused me too when I wrote that. I'm still trying to figure that one out, and it's been 3 days. He's currently down almost $2,500, and the stock is down 15.5% from his entry.
Let's actually do that. Let me pick up some more down here. Because I still think this too good of a trend line here to just not come into play here.
This isn't about trading styles, because that wouldn't be fair of me. However, I watch a lot of his videos, and almost all of his trades are shorts, because that's what his preferred trading style is. He mentions it often, and almost every time he loses while going long in a position, he says, "That's why I prefer shorting." I've seen him take many trades with similar setups, except he shorts it instead of going long. Especially after zero follow-through to the upside after the trend break, he would say that's a great opportunity to short. Almost anybody would say that. Additionally, he's taken many short trades in the spots where he adds to his position size. So, he's going long on something for the same reason that he would usually short in his other videos. I have enough faith in him to admit that this was an emotional trade after he didn't exit soon enough to keep the loss small, and not something he would recommend for other traders to do. It's a perfect example of rationalization, because it's avoiding difficult feelings by trying to explain behaviors logically. After not exiting the trade for failure to do what he wanted it to do, nothing that proceeded was logical. To you and I, and probably him after this day was over, we can see how that's contradictory. Going long on something for the same reason you would short something is a good example of how our mind tries to rationalize staying in a losing position in the hopes of returning to green. He's in too deep to change his mind. Timing reversals are hard, but one way to be better at them is by scaling in. However, this has to be your plan from the start, and you can't initiate a full position size on your first entry. Obviously, the trade plan was that the break of the trend line signified the start of a big move up, but when that didn't happen, everything changed. If his plan from the start was to begin with 100 shares and eventually build up to 500 by adding in more at further drops, then that would be good. Dangerous, and not suitable for all traders, but at least a logical plan. Now, his position size is 1,000 shares, which lowers the average cost. However, you can't average down forever, and not all things reverse, which is why people blow up their accounts. This was the mistake that I made when I first started. You have to continue increasing the size of your position in order to move an average. I'd show you the math, and I almost did, but then I remembered how boring math is. Just have faith in me that I'm not lying.
So I'm in at 27.72 as far as my average. Let's see if we can get a movement back upwards here.
Sounds okay, way, more good, 25. Way too good to be true, but it's...
He accidentally put the video overlay in here where he advertises how he achieved a 98% win rate, blah blah blah, whatever. Sell a course if you want to, I guess. What he said in the background was, added some more at 25. That's right, another 500 shares. He now has 1,500 shares and is down just shy of $4,000. The price of the stock is at $24.25, which is $5.74 below his initial buy-in price of 500 shares for $29.99. This would have meant being down 19% in the position, but because of the power slash danger slash reason traders fail slash, oh, sorry. Because of this, he is down more money, but only 6.5%.
Yeah, 26. Seems as though as that level can be broken, we got a good shot here.
He has continued to move down the price that he thinks will cause the stock to go up if broken, which is what our brains do to rationalize. We will grab out at things that confirm what we want to happen. Obviously, the break of this number is not why he entered the trade. Our brains are optimistic, and, like I said, we'll reach out at anything that supports what we want to happen, rather than what is most likely to happen. So, he has now exited the position. Remember, the point of this wasn't to say, oh my god, you are down $4,859 and the position is now closed with just a $692 profit. That is certainly shocking, but some people are capable of trading like that. I would say good job if that was the plan, but it wasn't. The plan was to get in after the price broke resistance because he thought it would go up after this. Instead of closing the position when it failed to have any follow-through and taking a small loss, he kept adding and adding to reduce the average cost while hoping that it would rebound. It was an emotional sequence of events, and I used it to demonstrate the ideas of cognitive dissonance and rationalization. This is the same reason I lost so much money when I first started, but I didn't get lucky. These are concepts that affect everyone, and it's what gave me a reality check when I first started. However, I hope to never do something like that again, and I've created a system that doesn't even allow me to do that in the first place. With chart trading, it would be impossible for me to keep averaging down, because before I enter a trade, I put the stop loss in a logical spot. The only direction I'm allowed to move that stop is closer to break even. Additionally, I'm not allowing myself to increase the position size. I would rather learn where to make good entries than to just keep increasing my position size, hoping to come somewhere close to guessing a pivot point in price. Don't be mean to Clay. We all make mistakes, and sometimes we make mistakes that end up working out. But the one time they don't is when we take a loss that hurts so bad you can't sleep or eat for days. Or is that just me? Oh, well, I hope this was helpful. Sometimes these concepts seem obvious, but that's just hindsight bias making it seem like information we didn't know before was already clear. You can follow me on Instagram if you'd like, at imantradingfutures, and if you enjoy these videos and want to see more, I would love it if you subscribed. My supply and demand video got picked up by the YouTube algorithm again, and there are a lot of new people here, so welcome to my channel, and never hesitate to ask questions even if you think they are dumb. As I've said before, at one point even Einstein had to learn the difference between right and left and up and down. And that Einstein guy was real smart. It makes me feel better when I put my shoes on the wrong way.
Hopefully you're looking and saying, wait a second, you let a stock drop 10% against you and you didn't have a stop loss. Where's your risk management? I mean, what are your risk control protocols? Like, how did you sit there and let something drop 10% against you? Now a 0.5%, 1%, okay, that's a much different story. But 10%, how did you let that drop against you? Because, well, they really don't know what they're doing. But they got bailed out by a 13% move back to the upside. And then what was their assessment of the situation? Hey, patience. Hey, no emotion. That pays off. Dunning-Kruger effect to the T. When you don't know what you don't know what sort of lesson you're actually supposed to take away from it. And I'm not even calling this person stupid because I get it.